Well, hello, friends. Welcome one and welcome all. I can't offer much in this outdoor hall, but sit here and rest. You must be weary, and I'll share with you Tales of Tyria. Yes, welcome one, welcome all. This week on Tales of Tyria, we've got a continued discussion of our hardcore versus casual. This time, it's competitive versus non-competitive. Stay tuned, this one's gonna get hot. Yes, welcome one, welcome all, welcome to another exciting episode of Tales of Tyria. Ladies and gentlemen, can you believe we are at episode number 15 and the game is still not out yet? All right, I am Bridger, a.k.a. Adam Ruzzo. Welcome to the show. This is your number one Guild Wars 2 podcast, at least I hope it is. I have no actual statistics to back that up, but I can dream. We appreciate that you got a hold of the program, however you may have found it. Please tell a friend or two about it, would you? Word of mouth is our best advertising. If you have anything that you think that we could do better, I appreciate letting us know. Feedback at talesoftyria.com is where you can get a hold of us. Also, leave comments on the webpage. Give us a review on iTunes. We do read all of that stuff, and I try to get back to as much email as I can and, you know, try to give you guys what you're looking for. So if you have a question, if you think we should discuss something, please send us feedback at talesoftyria.com. We've already got a lot of great stuff. We've got another email today from somebody we're going to talk about. Also, thank you to everyone who's donated so far. We've had quite a few people donating to help out the show because, believe it or not, web hosting costs money. But I did not know that getting into this. And so, you know, there you go. So I just wanted to personally thank Nathaniel, NT, and Michael, and somebody who does not have a name on here but donated $5. So thanks to everybody else who donated. If you feel like you want to help support the show, we'd certainly let you do that. It's on the Tales of Tyria website, talesoftyria.com. Let's go right on into this. Ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce right here, Kai. Welcome to the show.
Hi, guys. Glad to be back.
I got Vega. There's Kai. She got it right. I got it right. Okay. Excellent. All right. So, Kai, you missed last week's discussion because you gave you guys the day off. What is your favorite race? What are you looking forward to?
My favorite race, most people know, is Silvari. And I genuinely love them because they're kind of new. Like, there's not many MMOs that have a race that is made out of plants. So I'm excited.
This is true. Not too many. All right. Also up on the show, we have Vega, who is unfortunately known as Freelancer, according to this. There we go. Vega, welcome to the show. What is your favorite race?
My favorite race is the Asura.
The Asura. You just want to be racist, don't you? That's why I like them.
Mainly because it's in their description, it says they are a race of mad scientists, and that sounds awesome.
That's pretty much true. They're basically, if you took Stewie Griffin and turned him into a race just by himself, that would be a lot of inbreeding, but that's how it would happen. All right, and a brand new, well, not quite so new, host of the program. Here we have Overseer Cat. Welcome, Overseer Cat. Do you have anything to add on the favorite race? Are you going to go with, I'm going to guess you're going to say the Char. And I'm not even going to let you finish that sentence because I'm going to tell you why the Char are awesome. The Char are awesome because they like, I told you specifically we're not allowed to have masseuses during the show. So I'm just going to have to go back to the main thing here. That's actually Freelancer. Welcome.
How's it going, Bridger?
All right. So what is your favorite race? What are you looking forward to?
My favorite race easily is Silvari just because they're unique, but I will be playing in Asura.
Yeah.
So I just have to. I mean, unless they make it some completely obvious way of seeing an Asura and a massive World v. World players, you know, it's just, I'm going to have to roll Asura.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's the kind of thing that I thought. I mean, apparently, it's still going to be they've sort of balanced the hitboxes. But yeah, if you're an Asura next to a bunch of Norn humans and Char, you're going to be
Char, yeah.
You're going to be less likely to get clicked on.
I could probably fit my player model within a Char player model.
You can't click me. There.
Exactly.
You could fit in his leg, so you could fit like two Asuras to every Char.
Pretty much. You could get a third one like standing up like on top of their shoulders somehow. Oh, that would be great. Okay, so the chat room's throwing out Malkior found a version of... Let me see if I can pull this up, if this is going to come up correct. Oh, there it is. Blast! Unfortunately, that's so tiny, you can't see it. And it's got beer.
That's
all right.
So funny.
All right, let's not get distracted here, because this show is going to be a pretty good one. So, we don't have a lot of news this week, really. I kind of figured that we'd have a calm before the storm being open beta and all of the NDA release, you know, stuff once that finally happens. But I think that's still probably a couple weeks away. So, in the meantime, Nathan sent us an email, and he asked, in World v. World v. World, by the way, let me start this. Do you guys think it's okay? Can we just abbreviate it, like, collectively, as a community, say, we're just going to call it World v. World, and we're just going to know that there's a third one there? We don't need to call it World v. World v. World.
Third world.
That does seem kind of excessive.
That's a lot of W's, and I never pressed the W, so that finger is a little atrophied, so no, it's not true. Okay, so in World v. World, we don't know a lot about it, and he uses the a lot, meaning that giant... animal. A lot about it. Perhaps this is a topic for the show. Is 2 weeks too short? Say your server spends time and effort to build up its fort resource, only to have it completely reset after 2 weeks. What are your guys' thoughts on this? Vega, let's ask you if I can figure out you're the right button. Yes, Vega.
I think I like the concept of, you know, kind of resetting things, but I do feel that 2 weeks is probably a little on the short side. I'm not sure how long it should be, but I do like that they're talking about, you know, having things reset.
So, Freelancer, let me ask you then. So, what he points out in this is that for the beginning of the launch of the game, 2 weeks might not be a bad idea because you have no idea what the skill balance is going to be between varying servers. So you want the turnaround time to be fairly quick so that if you have two servers that just happen to randomly be paired up with each other and one team is just completely face rolling the other team, would that be a good thing to have sort of a shorter time period and then ramp it up over time?
I think in regards to start with that guy's comment, I mean, this is just another comment that's made with somebody that has no information about the game already.
Well, that's what we're doing here.
I mean, he's saying that if it's 2 weeks too short, I mean, for all we know, that World versus World is going to be so in-depth that 2 weeks is too long, you know. Or it might be such a fast-paced game is what I mean, where it'd be too long. Imagine if you did take over one of the server's main keeps, right? What are you going to do until then in World versus World, you know? And I just think it should be, it should keep you fast-paced. And I think 1 week is almost ideal, in my opinion. But I don't know. It depends.
The other thing to consider is that it seems like my kind of understanding is at the beginning of every new two-week rotation, you're going to have to start at like the very beginning and have the entire thing be neutral and fight your way, you know, sort of towards the middle map where all three of the servers are going to be fighting each other for the rest of the couple weeks. And if you never had that clean wipe starting back at the beginning, then you would never really experience that content at the very beginning because it would be probably very rare that a server would get pushed all the way back to the beginning. So that's a huge amount of content that's just kind of not doing anything, but by essentially resetting every 2 weeks, you get to replay that early content and then have like a full week or so fighting around the middle area if it's sort of a balanced fight. I don't know. Kai, do you have any extra thoughts on this idea?
I like the idea of resetting, but I think even though you're resetting and going back to the early game every time a new 2 weeks starts, the whole world as a whole is leveling, getting more skilled at the game, learning how to play their characters. So even though it resets, you're still a lot more skilled than the week before because you generally have a lot more knowledge about the game. So I don't think it will affect it that much. I think it'd be quite fun to actually go from losing terribly to actually winning like World v World because you've got a lot more skilled and more people have joined the server and things like that. So I think 2 weeks is fine.
Consider this also. Imagine being that server that gets stomped, okay, just gets annihilated like within the first 3 days because a couple of guilds got together and rolled on the same server and pushed them so hard that they just didn't expect it. So you're telling me that as that server, they also have to consider the fact that that server is going to pretty much give up. You know, and the appeal of World versus World, or whatever we want to call it, World PvP, is going to drop tremendously if they know they have to wait a week and a half in order to really play again. And it's there's a lot of variables that we don't know. I think it's still a little too early to talk about this, in my opinion.
Certainly. Dang, I just had another thought, and now it's completely gone. All right, well, I guess it's time to move on. That's what I was thinking. I just have to say, now that I'm kind of thinking about this two-week rotation right at the beginning, I have to say, and this is something that all MMOs kind of share, is that the first few months of an MMO are very different from the rest of its life. Like, that's a time when everybody in the world is leveling up together, basically. And so World versus World in the first month or two is going to be so different from World versus World at any other time in the game. Like, if you want to experience that, you have to buy it on launch day. You know what I mean? I just feel like that's going to be a really unique and interesting experience.
Yeah, I think that's a good point, because I think that's going to be the one time when everyone's going to be on a level playing field in terms of, you know, gear and skill. And it's not, there's not going to be any other time that's going to be as, like, raw as that.
Because then you're going to have people coming in or making alts, and they're going to be level 20 instead of level 80. Now, here's another question. I assume they're tuning all of the keep NPCs and, you know, whatever dynamic events are going on in World versus World for level 80 characters, right? Because everything's scaled up to 80, and they're probably assuming that everybody eventually is going to be level 80 there. But what happens when all of these level 1s go rushing into World versus World right at the beginning? They're trying to siege a castle, and they may actually be scaled up to level 80, but they only have, like, 6 skills. That's going to be a very interesting, very difficult encounter, I have to imagine.
As we've learned from previous MMOs, when you have enough people involved, it doesn't matter. even if all the elementalists only have fireball, we're going to fireball that keep lord down if that's what it takes. So
this is true. All right, so let's move on, I guess. If, like I said, that was a nice little mailbag piece from Nathan. If you guys have any more like that, please send it to us, feedback@tyria.com, because I'm running out of topics. I'm hoping we get some more soon. But if you have any topics you want to give us some ideas, we greatly appreciate it. feedback@talesoftyria.com. So let's move on to the roundtable. Ladies and gentlemen, this may seem like exactly the same thing we talked about 3 weeks ago, 2 weeks ago, with hardcore versus casual, but this is a very different subject, and there were specific things that we didn't talk about on purpose for that week in order to save it for this week. Competitive versus non-competitive. So I know that I have played in a number of very competitive sort of top guilds or clans in various games. Let me ask, I know, I'm pretty sure Freelancer, you have played in very, you know, what you would consider competitively in tournament scenes and things like that?
Yes, very much so.
Okay, Vega, have you engaged in that kind of, you know, high-level competitive play?
I have not.
Kai, what about you?
Not competitive, no.
All right, PvP. This is great, because we've got a very diverse panel. I love when that happens. So, chat room, I'm very interested. What about you? Have you, yes or no, have you played in a very competitive environment versus no, haven't played in a team-based competitive environment, or even 1v1 in like StarCraft or something like that? I'm just curious to see the split of the 30 or 40 or 50 or so people that we've got in the chat room here. Let's see.
Well, let's break it down. What do you consider competitive?
That's a good place. So we got lots of yes, 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 no, no, no. I mean, yes, 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 no, no, no. It seems like a pretty even split in the chat room as well. So I guess the way that I would define competitive would be in a scene with other like-minded either people or teams in a tournament-style environment. Either it's a ladder or a tournament, something that has specific rules about, you know, who is considered better than someone else. If you win a tournament, then you're the champion of that tournament, right? And there are specific rules. These are the things that you can do. These are the things that you can't do. These are the maps that you can play, etc. This is the one we're playing this week, if it's a league, for example. So sort of a structured environment, I guess, is what I'm getting at. And I think that is all you need in order to play competitively, as long as the structure is done really well. But in order to play really at the top of a competitive situation, you'd have to be playing in a group of people that really commit, I guess you could say, to the competitive scene. So what do you guys think of that definition? Freelancer, you're probably going to disagree with me. Let's go. Let's just get right to it.
No, I think you pretty much got it. I mean, competitive gamer versus somebody that's not competitive is just simply that. Somebody that is playing to win. It is somebody that is not necessarily hardcore or casual, but somebody that gets into the game, looks at their enemy roster, says, I'm going to crush these guys, and compares the scores and rankings afterwards. To be competitive, you have to have a set list of variables to define that you're better than somebody else. Whether that's a scoreboard, whether that's it could be any number of things. But anybody can be competitive. Now, whether you're good at it, it's another thing entirely. It
takes
a lot of
discipline. That's like me playing League of Legends. I try really hard.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure all of us can joke around and laugh at half the people in this chat, you know, that say they're competitive. They can be competitive, but do they really try to be competitive, or are they just trying to win, or are they actually training themselves? Are they viewing replays? So I guess you got different levels in my own view, but yeah, anybody can be competitive. If you're playing to win, you want to beat that other guy, that's competitive. That's the competitive spirit, and that's a good thing.
All right, any disagreement between Kai, Vega? Do you guys agree or disagree?
I would agree with that statement, but then I would then have to go back on the original question and say that like, I have played competitively, because I have done like Arena in World of Warcraft and played League of Legends, and I've gone in with the intention to win, otherwise I wouldn't have done it. But I wouldn't say that I would go in and be like, oh, I've got to play against this score and beat their ranking and things like that. I just play to win, but not competitively.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with that at all. I mean, there's people that do PvP and they go in for the lulls, and you know, if they lose, they lose. No big deal. And that's not.
Oh, I get angry.
You know, and then there's different types of competitive players. There's the ones that tear themselves apart afterwards. You know, if they lose, there's the ones that. I mean, we all know the ragers. We all know the different types, especially between like MOBAs and arenas and stuff. But you know, anybody could be a competitive player. So it's not.
I guess when I'm thinking of competitive, non-competitive, because by that definition, I'm competitive too, because whenever I'm playing, I'm always, you know, looking up tactics or looking up at this and that. But when I think of a competitive player versus a non-competitive player, I think of someone who's taking part in, like, community tournaments or community events, as opposed to just kind of playing by themselves. Or even if it's, you know, if they're part of a guild and you're playing, you know, clan versus clan or guild versus guild, some sort of community-based gameplay.
Yeah, it's very
on
difficult.
On a serious level.
It's very difficult to nail down, because it's really a nebulous thing, because what I want to say, what my brain sort of conceives of when we say competitive, is you can play competitively by yourself, like Freelancer's talking about. You go into the game, make certain plans, try and use every rule within the game to your advantage, and to me, though, when I think competitive, I think somebody who's playing in a structured environment that measures your win-loss. Like, if you play ranked in LoL, that's playing, you know, you're a competitive player at that point. If you're just playing regular, you can play as hard as you can, but you're not tracking anything, you're not playing on a static team or anything like that. So, as a result, you can play competitively, but not be a competitive player, because you're not taking place in competition, which is the root part of the word, right?
Well, I think that using the word playing competitively is misleading. It's either you're playing the game, because it's a game, and that's what you do. You play it. Mm-hmm. Or if you're playing it competitively, like you said, you're, you know, playing in tournaments, playing with communities, and, you know, taking it to the next level.
Malkior is determined to get us to adopt casual competitive. I think he's posted that like four times in the chat.
Casual. It's hard to say.
No,
like, casual competitive.
It's playing the game when you, you know.
It sounds like something like pedo bear is coming up. You want to be casual competitive?
Well, you know, he hits on a good point though, because you have a competitive player that can, let's say he actually has a life, right? You know, God forbid, and he can only play 2 hours a day, but he's sure that when he gets on for those 2 hours a day, if let's say it's League, we use that example, you know, he is out there to win. He's going to crush his opponent, and that's what he said on. And he's going to be down on himself if he loses one way or another. And he's going to be, you know, developing his skill if he wins, and he's going to be breaking down everything. Whereas a casual, you know, would not be. They're going to hop on. They don't care. I mean, this isn't their life, and that's the way they are. So I think to say that somebody's casual competitive, it's a silly term, but it's true. I mean, you do have a difference between somebody that's casually competitive and, like, hardcore, for example.
I think that would be me, casual competitive. In that description, that's, like, how I play. I play to win, and I get angry. If I die, I shout at people, and I swear. And if my boyfriend kill steals off me in League of Legends, I won't talk to him either. I get really angry, but then I won't play it for like 2 weeks because, you know, I'm doing something else or I'm busy. So I would say, yeah, I'm casual competitive, if that's a word.
I think there's too many names out there for all these different types of players.
Yeah. That's true. Now
I think it should just go pro, competitive, playing the game.
I think it's really interesting, we're kind of talking about almost two different things, like competitive versus non-competitive. To me, sort of in my own frame of reference, is playing in a competition versus playing in a pub or a pug or whatever. And then the other side of the coin is playing to win versus playing for fun. And the playing to win people, they get enjoyment out of improving their own skill at a game. Like, for example, people who play, you know, recreational basketball in the, you know, local town they're in. They play part on a team, and they practice, you know, a couple times a week, and they take part in tournaments within their state, things like that. You know, that is somebody who enjoys the game as a way that they can use to improve themselves. It's very easy. Games make a really fantastic way of measuring your own progress, because you either win or you lose. And you can check your stats. You either made 90% of your baskets or you made 50% of your baskets, to continue the basketball example. So games are fantastic for the satisfaction that we as humans get psychologically. Your brain loves it when you get better at things. It likes progression, to put it in MMO terms. So when you can track that really well by being in a competition and like seeing that, okay, last year we went, you know, 3-10, and this year we went, you know, 5-5 or 5-whatever, we're getting much better, right? So that means that that to me, playing to win is getting your joy, your jollies, I guess, out of that getting better at the game. Every time you learn something new, a new trick, a new thing, and you practice it, and you nail it, that feeling of satisfaction, like, yes, I just nailed that thing that I didn't know how to do before, and now I practice it, and now it worked. Like the first time you figure out how to flash across a wall in LOL, and you use it to save your ass, that is amazing feeling. You're like, yes, I just got out of there for, you know, the first time. That's amazing. 17th time, who cares? But then the other players are what I kind of think of as experiential players in games with lots of flash and explosions. They're just there to see the, whoa, did you see that nuke totally took out all your dudes? You know, like, you can get that at all kinds of games, from StarCraft to Company of Heroes to Team Fortress 2, just like a crit rocket just blowing up half a team and just going, whoa, that was hilarious. Meanwhile, the other guy's like, stupid crit rockets, they should take them out of the game. There's no reason. It was just a random number generator that got me killed. So, okay, I've been ranting long enough, but that's sort of the way that I see it.
That's why people rage in MMOs, because you have an achievement and there's 12 bosses and in the first week you do it, you kill one. The next week, you're now on 2 out of 12. And it's an easy path to see that you're being successful and that you're completing things. And in your brain, it's like, yes, I'm getting better. And you're working that way up to completing that achievement. And I think it's exactly the same for PvP. Like, you'll get 3 kills in one game. The next game, you'll get 5 kills. And you can see that you're getting better at playing this character or hero. And it's easy to see that you're improving.
I feel like we're trying to have this real high-level design discussion, nailing down terms to really get to the meat of what we're talking about. And all the chat room can do is, hey, look, the bird woke up. Or, oh, man, I bet Cat wants to eat the bird. It's
like, you know what makes me rage, Bridger? What do you consider a professional player or a pro player?
Oh, man, here we go. You got a pet peeve on that.
Here we go.
Well, so what is someone who gets paid to play.
All right, plus one. All right, so Vega, what is a professional player? If I say I am so pro at this game,
professional player is someone who's that is their life and livelihood. That is all they do, is that they train or play whatever game it is, and they compete in tournaments for money. And if they are not good at that game, they'll be out on the streets because that's their income and livelihood. To me, that's a pro-level gamer.
So keywords is income, livelihood, money, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
All right, because I cannot stand competitive gamers, and I have to say this like every 6 episodes. You know this, Bridger. I cannot stand... Okay, it's fine if you want to be competitive. If you want to carry that spirit, I applaud you. I really do. But do not go around saying just because you had a 10-kill streak that you are pro. It's massacring, like, esports in general. I hate to use that term, too. But
I don't think you'd see anybody in, like, high school football, if they scored a touchdown, they go, yes, I am so professional at this.
Wait, I think I need to, like, check my Twitter feeds. I'm pretty sure at some point I've been like, I'm so pro, pure ownage, yeah.
Well, I think
unless you've won a tournament, that's all I got to say, you know, and you've actually been paid to play the game, you can then even borderline calling yourself a pro. It just drives me insane because you take all the credit away from these real pro teams like Guild Wars 1 players that say they were pro at Guild Wars 1. You know, it takes the credit away from real Guild Wars 1 teams like War Machine and Eagle that were really pro by definition. And you get a bunch of competitive gamers that may have had a winning streak, and it just detracts the whole scene. So yeah, that's my little... side topic.
I agree. I think the term pro has been adopted in games like completely differently, but yeah, as I originally said, I think it's someone who does it as a job, or like as we all kind of said, does it full time, and you know, they are actually good at it and have some thing that can show that they are good at it, like winning a tournament or being ranked or something that, you know, takes a long time to get.
Okay. Yeah. let me change the topic a little bit here. I think we can all agree that you can be competitive when playing PvP, right? That's clearly the case. You can also be non-competitive when you're playing PvE. You can just, you know, some people like to just enjoy the grind. It's sort of just this easy thing that lets them unwind after work or what have you. They don't really get into it competitively. They're obviously not competing against anybody. But let me ask this question. Can you have non-competitive PvPers? I think we just kind of touched on that, but more importantly, can you have competitive PvEers?
Yeah,
what do you think, Vega?
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, I don't think you can't have pro PvEers, obviously, because the game's not going to pay you for beating it.
That's not true. When I beat a level in Pac-Man, I don't have to put another quarter in order to keep playing. But no, that's a great example. I mean, the leaderboards on Pac-Man, that's competitive PvE, isn't it?
No.
What do you mean no?
If it's the leaderboards, you're playing the other people on the leaderboards. You're not
exactly.
playing.
Yeah, that's PvP.
PvP.
Yeah, I guess.
Pac-Man, but
you're not directly playing against another player. You're playing against the game, the player. You're playing against the environment for a score, and then you compare that score with other players. I think that qualifies as competitive PvE.
That's similar to like guilds that rush on new servers in WoW for, you know, the world first, like taking down a certain raid.
Yeah.
I think that's competitive PvP. I mean, think about it.
Yeah, you're it's sort of a made-up game. Yeah. Because I don't think you get recognition for being the first guild in a server to take down a new raid boss. They just, you know, they like to...
Sure
they,
do.
You don't get...
Yeah, you do. Like, you're, like, worship. Yeah,
no, sure but, I mean, but I mean mechanically. The game doesn't, like, put in your guild's profile, okay, we confirmed that this guild beat, you know, Naxxramas first.
You all have an achievement, and sometimes...
Oh, they did put an achievement in. I didn't know that.
You know, something synonymous with being competitive is having the notoriety that goes along with being successful, right?
So, I was just saying, I wasn't sure if the game would, like, confirm that and prove it to people.
Well, yeah, you have achievements and stuff.
You get achievements, and sometimes even a title if you're, like, the first.
Interesting.
And then also, you know, another example would be the people that rush... It's, I always think it's silly, but... I did it too, so I'm guilty of rushing to like level 80 first when a new server launches, stuff like that.
Yeah.
Speed running. There's all sorts of different ways, and it's all competitive, even though you're not physically facing another player.
Yeah, it's an efficiency system that you're trying to solve, essentially.
It's a competitive atmosphere where others recognize you for it. And with achievements and world first and stuff, yeah, I think it can be competitive. Very competitive, actually.
Even Blizzard in BlizzCon, they have that one segment where they take the best raiding team in all the game and they throw them in a field with like every single raid boss out there, just one after the other. And you have people sit there watching it, and it's actually somewhat entertaining. But I mean, that's, you know, they have to somehow base who's the best raid group. Somehow they figure that out. So, yeah, I mean, I agree with you that PvE can be competitive. I just was making a joke that it can't be pro.
Yeah, the chat room brings up a really good, like, kind of little side topic, Bridger. What do you think is the difference between someone boasting their achievements or claiming their achievements and, a.k.a., stroking their EP? What do you think about that?
Well, yeah, I mean, there's that, but it's also the kind of thing you want to be recognized for winning a tournament in StarCraft, right? You want to be recognized. I mean, that's part of the release. It's sort of like a cathartic experience almost. You struggle and you sacrifice to practice and put in the time and, you know, even in some cases spend your own money on travel to get to some of these tournaments. And then the payoff is the recognition. And obviously the actual payoff of the money, but then the other payoff psychologically is the recognition of other people that, hey, this guy's the best at this, you know, game in this particular tournament. So I think you could say it's stroking your epine, but that doesn't seem to do it justice in my book. Like, you could say the same thing. You know, the people who wear their NFL Super Bowl ring, they're just stroking their ego. What are they doing, those stupid people, right? I mean, but people, you know, put a lot of stock in that. I think that's the question. If you're just like, you know, say, hey, I sold 10, you know, pets on the Guild Wars auction house today. That makes me awesome. That nobody's going to be like, what are you kidding me? Like, but if it's an actual, this comes back to actually being an achievement you can be proud of, I think then it doesn't really, you know, it just shouldn't be any detriment to stroking your own ego, I guess you could say.
It's bragging rights.
Bragging rights, exactly. That's the best
term. It relates to real life as well. Like, if someone's worked all their life really hard and you know them and they finally got this car that they've wanted, they can be like, yay, I've got my new car. But if someone's like, hey, look at my car. It's amazing. Like, you're just like, you're an idiot. Like, stop bragging. I think, yeah, it depends, like, what it's about. Like, if you get an achievement, someone knows you've worked for ages, and you finally, like, yes, I've got it, and you're generally just, like, really happy about it, I think that's fine. But if you're, like, shoving it in people's faces, like, oh, I've got this achievement, you haven't, I'd like me now, like, I think no one will like it.
All right. Actually, there was competitive PvP in Guild Wars 1 in the face of what do they call those missions? No, I can't remember off the top of my head. Malkior, help me out. There were these missions that you were able to essentially sort of race through. It was a challenge missions. There we have challenge missions. And I believe, but I didn't, you know, Wikipedia this or anything, that you basically tried to get through these missions as fast as possible. And it sort of had a leaderboard system where your group of eight people would try to, you know, get through them as fast as possible and compare your time against other people. Or maybe there was a score based on, you know, how much stuff you killed or something like that. So I hope that we see something like that. Obviously, that they haven't mentioned anything like that. It probably won't be there on launch, but I'd love to see something like that in the future, because I think that's a really unique way of having some form of PvE content, indirect competition, I guess is what you'd call it.
Yeah, I think that's a really fun way of showing, because you got that in every game out there. I mean, Mario speedruns, you know, all sorts of things. And it's always intriguing, and you got to really respect the skill of that person, of how much they practice to get that perfect time, you know. Even games I haven't played, I watch them. I like watching this. So
I know there's a tournament in China or Korea, where there used to be, that it was in Final Fantasy VII. Like a speed run to see who could kill Emerald Weapon the fastest, and it was like an actual tournament that was going on for a while. Wow. After I saw that, I was like, "Really? Like,
interesting."
Yeah.
All right. So this is where we start getting a little bit dicey, because oftentimes usually when someone is losing, they will cry a number of different things. And usually it's in defense of their own ego.
I know where this is going.
But there's a number of things that the losing player will bespatter the winning player with in order to degrade them. So the things that come off the top of my head are abuse. You're abusing that champion. That's abuse. Or exploit. Or
lag.
Try hard is one that I've been hearing recently, and I guess that's a negative Me connotation. Team. You try too hard. This is a game. What are you trying so hard for? So such a weird argument. That is just the most amazing argument I've ever heard. But apparently that makes sense to people. So let's talk about I guess two that are kind of related is exploit and abuse. Kai, why don't you break it down for us? What is your definition of an exploit?
An exploit, I think, is something that's found that's not meant to be in the game, that people are doing full knowingly that they're not meant to do it to have an advantage.
It's something that clearly is able to be done because you can do it, but it clearly breaks the spirit of the rule. You're breaking the spirit of the rule, even if you're not breaking the rule itself. Like bunny hopping in the old Quake games. Clearly, exactly. It was allowed. There was a bug that allowed you to basically be frictionless and gain speed if you jumped and moved in this specific way.
There was a bug in Rift for quite a while, if anyone played it, that in PvP, that if you jumped up and down, then melee players couldn't hit you, so people would be like jumping all around the maps, and like it was really bad. And then eventually, obviously, someone will notice from the development team and fix it. But until then, that's what I would call an exploit, something that everyone knows is wrong, but people do it to have an advantage.
Okay, so that's a great definition. So it's something that everyone knows is clearly against the spirit of the game. It was not intended by the designers.
I disagree.
And it was not balanced.
I don't think every exploit is against the spirit of the game. There's some notable exploits throughout gaming history that improve the gameplay.
Oh no, I'm not trying to put a value judgment on it. I'm just saying the whatever you're doing, in order for it to be called an exploit, it has to be something that is possible without using third-party software, for example. Because if you had to use third-party, that's cheating. It has to be done without altering the fundamental rules of the game. But if you simply use the rules in a way that was not intended by the designer and was usually directly opposite intended of the designer. Because the intention in the bunny hopping example is you go this fast unless you have some kind of speed boost buff from the game. And players were able to break that restriction by doing something the designer never intended. Now, whether that improves the game or doesn't is a value judgment. And that's where I was going to go next. So let me ask you, Freelancer, does calling something, labeling something an exploit automatically mean it has a negative connotation?
I think the mass public thinks so. But, I mean, there's some exploits that, like how many people remember the good old days of concussion grenade jumping or jumping?
Oh, yeah.
As we called it. I mean, that we brought up bunny hopping. I mean, I think there's a lot of examples we could all go down over and over that it brought so much metagame to it, you know, that it's actually an improvement. And I think the developers were like, wow, we didn't think of that. And they're just like, well, that's pretty cool, you know, because both teams can do it. And I think in a lot of a lot of what people call exploits is more out of rage than anything, but most people don't understand that it can be done both ways. Just because somebody took the time to learn that particular skill, yeah, abilities, and prowess, that doesn't mean that that automatically makes it OP or broken or any number of things that people say in a fit of rage. I think exploits should be very carefully labeled.
That's something that I find really odd when people, for example, have exploits or they say, oh, that hero's OP. It's like, you have the opportunity to play that hero as well. Like, if you take the time to learn how to play it, then you will be just as OP as the other guy, but people don't. So it's their loss, I guess.
All right, Vega, go ahead. Finish your thought.
I was just going to say that, like, the whole bunny hopping and con jumping, I don't view those as exploits. An exploit to me is just a downright bug in the system that is, you know, it wasn't meant to be there. Someone found it, and it just completely is exploiting the game.
Well, I think originally concussion grenades and bunny hopping, those were bugs. I mean, the designer didn't build the code for moving through the world with the intention that players were going to be able to accelerate while moving.
So that is a bug, I
would say.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is that when that bug is discovered, they decided to, well, in that case, it's not as much of an exploit or a game-breaking sort of thing as, you know, I'm trying to think of an example. There was an with Dota 2, there was an example in a previous tournament that when this one hero used an ability, he was able to get out of any stuns or anything like that. So, you know, that the whole game is based around stuns. So if you can't stun him, it's completely breaking the game. And to me, that's an exploit when you're breaking
the game.
Because
it wasn't the goal of the ability. The ability didn't say breaks all stuns.
No,
it said does a bunch of damage or something else completely unrelated, and it just happened to also have a bug that caused it to break stuns.
Yeah, so in that point, it's a bug that was determined that it's an exploit, so we got to get rid of it. With like bunny hopping and con jumping, it was a bug that people determine that it's not really game-breaking. You know, yeah, so it takes a little skill to actually do it, so that doesn't really break the game. It's not something blatantly obvious as, you know, do this and you could kill someone in one shot kind of thing.
Okay, and now I want to hear everybody's answer to the following question. We'll start with you, Vega, because you're right here.
Okay.
So, let's say you come across some kind of exploit, or some, not even necessarily an exploit, but some ability, some character, some faction, some tactic, that if you execute it, it is widely considered to be game-breaking in one way or another. Game-breaking meaning it's so efficient, so optimal, that to do anything else will lose you the game, because this particular way is just so good. So you come across that. How do you deal with it? Do you use it? Do you disparage other people who use it? Because I know there's a lot of people that do that. What do you think, Vega?
I don't know. I mean, well, it's very situation dependent, I guess you could say. But I mean, I wouldn't really use it myself. It depends on how game breaking it is. Or I guess, are you trying to get at the whole abusing kind of?
Yeah, sort of that concept, because there's often gray areas where many people think something is an exploit or something is overpowered, broken, doesn't, you know, it makes the game boring, whatever, and other people think it's fine.
I guess, you know, with certain exploits, I mean, I feel that there's always a way around certain things, and it's just some of them are harder to find. So I wouldn't stoop to the low of also using an exploit to beat your exploit. I would try and find a different way, and if I couldn't find a different way, I would just not play with you. I don't know. I guess that when I'm kind of looking at abusing, the very basic example of when people say, oh, you're abusing that skill or that player's overpowered, like the good old days when you're playing Street Fighter and you have that one guy who's just sitting there and sonic boom, sonic boom, and then you get close and he does the freaking kick, you know? Like, that's in that, yeah, he might be abusing the skills, but you can beat him if you want to. It's just going to be annoying to, but it's not, you know, you don't have to fight fire with fire. You could find a way to get around it.
All right, Kai, same situation. You're faced with a game where it's a game that you really like, but there is some kind of exploit, some kind of game-breaking thing that just is way super powerful. Do you use it?
I would say no. I've been in a situation before. I can't think of an example, but I'm pretty sure in Rift or in WoW, at some point in the class that I played, there was like an exploit. But I don't like it because I generally think it ruins the game. It ruins the fairness and the fun, and that's why I play it, because I enjoy playing it rather than cheating. Otherwise, I would just cheat and get hacks. And
it feels like cheating, doesn't it, often?
Yeah, I don't like that. I would rather play fairly. And if bugs are there, I'm the kind of person that would report them, especially in like betas and things like that. So, no, I probably wouldn't use them.
All right, Freelancer, what is your thoughts? When is it okay to use something that some people decide in their head, and they'll yell at you about it? They'll say, you're just abusing Champion X, or you're just abusing that ability or that class. When is it okay to use it? Is there a line? Is there some kind of concrete rule we can say, this is when it's okay?
Very simple. Is there official notice out from the developer saying if you use it, it's wrong? If there's not, I'm going to use it all day. I mean, if that's something that, like a champion that I use, for example. If there's an official notice out from developers and not QQers that it's an exploit, then who can possibly say that it is an exploit? You run into a lot of people that are just plain idiots, and they're going to cry over anything that beats them. And until I would hear official word about it, I would assume that anybody else taking it seriously would probably use it too, if that's within their realm of play. Now, on the other hand, if I heard, let's say there was a notice saying from a forum representative or something, or perhaps a upcoming patch notes that they're switching that particular champion or skill, well, then that's plain and obvious. Don't be an idiot. I mean, it's for the sake of your reputation. If you're going to continue using that when everybody in the community knows that it's going to be changed because it is an exploit, it was officially labeled by patch notes or otherwise, then that's where morality steps in, and that professional players will take the high road and
sportsmanship.
Sportsmanship, yeah. That we're going to work around this, and that's where other players that don't have anything else to work for are going to continue using it as long as they can. And that defines very down the middle those you respect and those you don't respect. And keep that in mind, people.
I have very similar sort of thoughts to you as to when something is okay versus it isn't. Except what my sort of barometer is I got from reading David Serlin's book, Playing to Win. And his recommendation always sounded to me like the best. If there is a tournament or competitive scene for the game that you're playing, if there is a consensus amongst the top, competitive players in the best, leagues, the best ladders, whatever it is, to the point where they decide to ban thing X from the tournament or from the game because maybe the developers aren't patching it anymore, or maybe it's not a game that can be patched, like it's an arcade game like Street Fighter or what have you. For whatever reason, if it's not getting patched because it can't be patched, if it's banned from a tournament scene, from a high-level tournament scene, not just, my buddies down the street don't let me play it at their house anymore, but from a respected tournament level, if the consensus is, we've been playing with this for a while, and it makes the game less competitive, less fun, it makes it more boring, that's my sort of draw the line. But I also agree with you that if the developers also say, hey, this is a problem, we're changing it, because we've recognized it as a problem, that's another clear sign, don't use it. But other than those two things, it seems to me that your job as a competitive player, your job as a player, is to try and win the game with every means necessary. And the victory conditions are well defined, and the things that you can do within the game are extremely well defined, because they're hard-coded, they're written into the code. In a board game, for example, the only rules enforcers are the players at the table. In a video game, in an MMO, the game itself enforces the rules. You cannot simply jump 10 feet into the air by hitting the space bar, because when you hit the space bar, you only jump 2 feet in the air. That rule is enforced by the game rules themselves, the hard code that makes up the game. So, if you're playing by those rules and not cheating by breaking, into the game and changing things, then you should not be disparaged by the rest of the community. Obviously, with the exception that Freelancer just mentioned and the one that I was talking about. But I, all too often, I see people calling horrific names or sort of basically, trying to say competitive players ruin the game for other people because they use the most optimal thing. I just want to play this game and have fun, but I can't because I keep losing because the competitive players find and abuse the most overpowered thing. So let me ask, has anybody ever been in the position to have leveled that accusation against someone at any time in their past? Because I know I have. At one point in my gaming history, I was that guy.
That way you were laying down the ban hammer?
Well, no, I was sort of rehashing a number of different great articles, by the way, at teamlegacy.net. That one of them that was written by me, I also posted on the Tales of Tyria page here. You might have seen it, called Playing to Win, Fail Better. And there's a couple other great ones on the Team Legacy site about how to lose well and how to learn from your losses, etc. But the one that I'm specifically talking about is a game called Rise of Nations. This is one of my favorite games of all time. And I managed to get into sort of a press beta for that. I don't remember even how. I think I won a copy of it somehow through some contest. And I was playing a very early, you know, before the game was out, release of the game. And there was a rush, a particular rushing strategy, where the German player or a Japanese player who got very special heavy infantry would build a couple of barracks and pump out a bunch of heavy infantry and come at your base at like the 3 or 4 minute mark. And if you didn't do anything to stop them, they'd just destroy your base. It had not enough defense to take care of it, and it would take you out of the game completely. And I immediately went onto the forums after I got hit with this the first time, and I was like, "Big Huge Games, I demand that you do something about this! This is not how the game should be played! I will not do that! This has to be..." And, let me just say, I was pretty in my place. Because not like 3 or 4 hours later, one of the developers comes on the forum and goes, "So, yeah, not to make you sound stupid, but you could have built one unit and basically destroyed his rush and then completely out-teched him for the rest of the game because he destroyed his entire economy to do that to you. All you had to do was build one archer." And I was like, "What do you mean one archer? One archer won't kill five, dude." He's like, "Well, if you micro it by popping it in and out of your town center, it's really easy to just kite them and kill them, and then they die." And I was like, "Oh, really? Well, now I feel kind of stupid." And it's that kind of...
I think the best example of that throughout history for the last 10-plus years is StarCraft, period. The Zerg Rush. I mean, I know you're not a big StarCraft player, Bridger, but everybody can relate to what a Zerg Rush is, mm-hmm. and all the QQers that respond to it. To this day, on Team Liquid, people posting threads about whether it's Forgating or whether it's just Zerg Rushing, period, that how overpowered it is, or how much it's broken, or almost all... It's hilarious, to be honest with you, because it's like your Rise of Nations... scenario, it's very easily countered if you actually learn the meta game. And I think that's going to happen in Guild Wars 2 also.
Absolutely.
I mean, I think that with...
I guarantee you we're going to see teams of like 5 thieves, for example, that are just going to like all stealth and insta-kill players. Just come out of stealth and boom, just kill people. And people are just going to be crying, "Oh, that's terrible, abuse, nerf stealth, nerf this," when somebody else who's actually, you know, decides ahead of time, "I don't know for a fact that this is overpowered because I have not explored, nor have I given time for the community as a whole to explore." Because the other thing you have to remember, you have to try and be a little humble. Just because you haven't figured out what the counter to that is doesn't mean that the counter doesn't exist. And I would say 9 times out of 10, you are not going to come up with the way to beat it. Because only one person can come up with the way to beat it, usually. And then it spreads throughout the world as more people see that it become effective against, you know, something like, you know, a Zerg Rush or something like that. So you have to be humble. You have to remember, A, you're not the person who's going to come up with that, and B, just because it's a fallacy. It's one of the fallacies, and I can't remember what it was. But anyway, the point is that it's very difficult to determine whether something is actually broken or just appears broken because you don't know enough to know how to counter it. And I could totally see that happening in Guild Wars 2. So hopefully, people listening to the podcast will get this message, and they won't be one of those players that jumps on the forums after every loss and complains about the thing that killed them. You have to give it time. And one great thing which I recommend to everybody, if you ever think that something is really overpowered, something is unstoppable, use it. Use it yourself, and you will find out really quickly the weaknesses of that thing that you thought was unstoppable. Because when you start playing it, other people will know how to counter it, and they will kick your ass with it. And then you go, oh, I see.
So everybody in all of our audience now, just a quick poll. If we had, judging from the gameplay videos we have so far, you can leave out Mesmer if you want. What do you think is going to be the biggest class that everybody's going to scream OP about? What do you think about that? That's a good question. Jay, what do you think is going to be the first class that people are rising up in forums saying it's so OP?
Elementalist. Look at that. Elementalist. Hands down.
That's the class I'm playing.
That's my class, man, but it wasn't because they think it's going to be OP. It's because I love the idea of having so much versatility. I love the idea of having 25 different things at my fingertips and just going, what do I want to use to solve this particular problem?
Yeah, exactly. That you can play any role and... like, it's just so good that you can just switch all the achievements and yeah.
I think the only reason why I think a lot of people say Elementus right now is because whatever video it was that the one guy was just like
destroying everyone with
the Elementalist. I think everyone was like, oh my god, the Elementalist is going to destroy everyone. But, you know, we haven't seen a lot of. We haven't seen that much PvP videos. And I feel like no matter what happens, there's always a way to counter something.
Yep. In addition, you have to remember that those videos, the class combination,
there's always a counter to it somewhere. Even if it hasn't been like designed in yet, maybe it's, you know, something needs to get like
tornado OP.
You know, something, but there's always a counter out there. It's just a matter of actually finding it.
I tend to agree. All right.
But engineers for the win.
So, I mean, what I always recommend, and I hope that people in the audience that may have done this in the past can maybe have learned something from our conversation here today. But the other thing is, even if something is overpowered, something is broken, don't ever blame the player for using everything at their fingertips to win the game. Obviously, if they're cheating, that's a different story entirely, but if they're using everything within the context of the game itself to win the game, it's not their fault if it's overpowered. Blame the designers. Write to them and complain about how bad it is. Don't get all mad and type out in chat, you abuser, you go to hell, blah, 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 blah. It's not the player's fault. The player's job is to find the most optimal and efficient way to get to the victory conditions. That's the job of the player. If you get mad at them for doing that, you're getting mad at yourself for doing that whenever you win. It's a complete hypocrisy to try and do that to people. So
that's a pet peeve of mine,
if people get mad at players for playing competitively.
How many people flamed everyone who was doing the boosting in Battlefield 3? I know I did.
Describe that for everybody.
The boosting was, you know, you get someone with the EOD bot, and you just keep on shooting and you can repair it, and you could get an ungodly amount of experience and level up really quick. But if you ever saw someone doing it in a game, or if you did it in a game, everyone was just either team killing you if they could, or just yelling at you unrelentlessly.
Oh, well, that, though, however, does not quite apply to what I'm talking about, because he wasn't trying to aid the team in achieving the victory conditions. And that kind of segues perfectly into our next discussion. What do you guys consider greifing? What does that word mean to you? Kai, what do you think?
Greifing, I think, is just when someone's doing something deliberately to annoy you, and they know that if someone was doing it to them, it would be really annoying, and they're preventing you from enjoying the game. So if they know that they can kill you, they're going to do it over and over again because they know it's possible, and it's really, really annoying. And, yeah, I think it's generally just being an idiot and pissing people off.
It's trolling. That's what it is.
Yeah, it's just...
By pure definition, I mean, you're doing it to get a rise out of the player. I mean, it's That's all it is. I mean, it's going to happen. Nothing we say or nothing any developer is going to do is going to stop it because it's coded into immature little brats. So, I mean.
Well, there's that. But I think there's a wider and better definition, one that I heard at one point. I think it was on the Geek Nights podcast, if anybody has ever listened to those. Their definition was every time you play a game, we all sit down or stand up in the case of soccer or football, but we all get together and agree that the victory conditions of this game matter to us. Because they don't really matter to us, right? Not unless you're playing on a professional level. Most of the time, if you sit down to play Monopoly with somebody, or you sit down to play Risk or Catan or any other crazy board game, or you sit down to play Quake, or you sit down to play World of Warcraft or Guild Wars 2, you sit down and you say, okay, I am fundamentally accepting that these victory conditions mean something to me. They don't mean anything in reality. They don't mean food. They don't mean water. They don't mean relationships. But just for the course of this game, in order to make the game work, we all have to buy in that the victory conditions mean something. If you don't buy into those victory conditions, or if the victory conditions for you change, that's griefing. If your personal victory condition is to annoy the most other people as possible to get a rise out of them, that's griefing. If your personal victory condition is level up as fast as I can in Battlefield 3, that's griefing. If your personal victory condition is I'm just going to go AFK in a battleground so that I can gain levels, that's griefing. These are all things where you break the game by not buying into the victory conditions of the game itself. That's my definition. I think it fits pretty much every situation where somebody would call something griefing.
I think anything that deviates from the grand goal, kind of like what you're saying, it, I guess, could be defined as griefing. I mean, or if it has the intent of getting a lot of AKA lulls, then trolling. But yeah, I mean, it's going to be in every game. I mean, griefing's going to happen. It's going to take a better player to learn how to work around that. But for those that don't know how to work around it,
I think the only workaround is not to play with griefers.
But you can't avoid that, though.
No, of course you can't avoid it if you're playing with public people, obviously. The only way to truly avoid it is to choose a set of players and go into a server alone together, which is why it's kind of awesome that we're going to have, you know, personalized servers for Guild Wars 2, by the way. Because you'll be, theoretically, from what I understand, you'll be able to have, like, administrator control. You'll be able to kick people out if they come on your server and they're griefing.
Yeah, that, and I mean, that's, if you think about it, that's the whole reason of having clans, guilds, you know, whatever you want to call them. I mean, it's to have that controlled environment where you could, if you have a consistent griefer or somebody that is just, that's what they enjoy out of gaming is to ruin your game, you can remove them from that environment. I think this is something that's outside the realm of competitive play because I don't think you'd quite find those types of players or kids in higher level competitive gaming at all. So,
because usually the point of competitive play is to actually complete the victory conditions as set. In order to play competitively, you have to buy in to the victory conditions of gain X points before the other team does, in example of Conquest Guild Wars 2, for example. You can't just decide in the middle of your competitive match that I actually only care how many kills I get and I don't care about winning the match, because obviously at that point you're not buying into the victory conditions anymore, and that's griefing. Or I only care about, you know, sitting on the trebuchet. I don't want to move from the trebuchet, even if my team needs help, even if somebody else would be better on the trebuchet. I just want to sit here and farm kills on the trebuchet, even if that means my team isn't good. Even if I know for a fact that my team needs me out there. That's what I want to do, and that's, you know, that could be considered griefing under my definition. And you don't see those people in competitive play because competitive players play to win. So there! I don't know why I needed to end that point in a very clear and obvious ha-ha, because I'm not arguing with anybody. We all agree on this damn subject. All right. We are, though, over about an hour and 5 minutes here, so I think it's about time to wrap it up. Any final thoughts? Competitive play, griefing, exploits, anything we missed here, guys? In the chat room, you think we missed anything? Anybody on the cast here?
Nope.
No, I think we're good.
Now with 66% more trebuchet on Tales of Tyria. We have to talk about the trebuchet every time. One of the best things I've ever heard was a custom taunt or sort of thing that you could put into Age of Empires 2. And it was, is that a trebuchet in your pocket? Or are you just trying to siege me? Are you just happy to siege me? That was the... Oh, man, that's terrible. I don't know why I threw that in there. But I guess that is going to sort of close us out for today. So, there we go. What happened to my hard drive? My hard drive disappeared again. Come on now.
Yeah, any of you guys listening in, just kind of want to kind of plug this. Bridger mentioned it earlier. Guru is a great place to talk about PvP in general and such, but if you guys want to get nitty-gritty with the psychology of competitive gaming in general, we got Bridger wrote a very good guide for Team Legacy, as well as another good friend of mine, KW, in regards to losing and actually learning how to play competitively. And if you guys, any of you listening, podcast or otherwise, definitely check them out. At the very least, we kind of hope it gives you some inspiration, because it does take a certain mindset to be competitive. A lot of people say they're competitive, but they really don't know what it actually takes if you want to be good at it. And I think that's important that more and more people are enlightened. It'll improve the community in general, and hopefully, spreading the word, we can kind of improve the whole esports scene of Guild Wars 2. Listen, I was about to say StarCraft 2. But it's such a bad thing. I really hope that. What do you think about this, Jay? Do you think the community of Guild Wars 2 is going to be taken seriously as far as a sport? What do you think about that?
I hope so. The thing is that, like, nowadays when you say competitive sports, everyone automatically just compares it to StarCraft 2, and there's
some people.
What's wrong with that? Nothing. StarCraft, but. What's wrong with it is that some people automatically think, well, if you're not as good as StarCraft 2, then just don't even bother being an esport. And I think that's a terrible attitude. I think that, you know, with time, Guild Wars could definitely work its way up and be a good... You know, like, there's not many good PvP MMO-type esports out there. And I think that Guild Wars is in a good position to try and, you know, be the premier for that.
I think... A quote by Mohandas Gandhi is appropriate here. And this, I think, is going to apply... What?
No,
I'm trying to bring it up intellectual level here. although I did just look this up because I kind of remembered a piece of it and just Google. Google is your friend, by the way. So I think this is how we as Guild Wars 2 players are going to be perceived. You know, first they ignore you. Then they laugh at you. Then they fight you. And then you win. So with that, we're going to wrap up the show. I think Guild Wars 2 is going to be... has getting past the ignore phase. People are now saying, it's not going to be like, wow, her. Soon enough, they're going to be like, hey, I heard some good stuff about this. Let me check it out. And then they're going to stick around. I have high hopes for it, ladies and gentlemen. High hopes. Reminder... Feedback at talesoftyria.com is how you can get a hold of us. Let us know what you think we should be talking about next week, because I honestly have no idea. I need ideas. I hope we get some news. All right. That is that. Chat room, thank you guys for showing up. We had 93 people this week. Fantastic. Woo! We're getting more every time.
It peaked at 100.
We peaked at 100. That's a new record.
Awesome. Awesome. Yeah. All right, so thanks for everybody for donating. Thanks for the feedback. Tell a friend. Tales of Tyria, signing off. Have a good one.
Bye. See you guys.